be thou. That good Ruha is God. So now that you know that God is with you, let us come and be in service together in the spirit of a living God. Amen? Yes. Of a living God. We're so grateful once again to have our bishop here with us on today. Healing and moving slow and gingerly, but determined to do the preach word. Amen. That's what you call a servant of the Lord. As we come this morning for our call to worship and prayer, I just want to say to each of you, be not discouraged. Be not dismayed. For God is still in the blessing business and working it out on your behalf. I just feel that I know we've had a spring forward. So in that spring, you ought to be ready to leap forward. Don't look at what's behind you, but look forward to what's ahead of you. And know that many bountiful blessings are in this spring season, even though we're preparing for snow. Let our hearts not be heavy.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Let us look to the hills. Let us come with our help. Dear God, we thank you on today, God. God, we thank you, God, on today, God. God, we thank you for your holy healing power on today, God. God, we thank you, God, for bringing our bishop, God, back into the house one more time, God. Giving her the use of all the activities of her limbs, God, we thank you, God. God, we thank you that she is able to move and breathe, God, in her being, God. Because of you, God, we give you all the glory, God. God, we know we could have been dead and sleeping in our grave, but God, you spared us one more time. God, I thank you, God. God, I thank you, God, for bringing her back, God. In her life, God, that walk beside her, God, day and night, we thank you, Jesus. God, we thank you on today, God, for you are worthy to be praised. God, I want to thank you for every heart and every mind that are here today, God, to lift you up in praise and give you the praise.
It's my time. greater is here. I am taking possession of all that God has for me. Healing is here. Deliverance is here. New life is here. Power is here. It's a new time in my life. I will do what I was born and destined to do. Obstacles are removed. Blockades are erased. Negativity is no more. Doors are open and paths are clear. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Greater is God that is within me than he that is within the world. Let us all shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It is Lenten season and we know we're making ready the way, so make ready the way for greater. We're going to ask if our ensemble would come back at this time and sing and prepare for us our hearts and minds as we will receive our bishop for the preached word on this morning. And for those of you who are joining us by Facebook, live stream and Periscope, we ask that you would go to empowermentliberationcathedral.org. And if you find it not to be robbery, would make a donation to this ministry if it is blessing you in any way. And we thank you for joining us. And we ask that God would bless you, and God would be with you, and peace would be upon you.
Lent season, and I do believe that this is what the Lord would have me to say on today. So once you find Mark chapter 8, if you would stand to your feet, verse 22. You would all stand. The word of the Lord says, they came to Bethsaida, and some people brought a blind man and begged Jesus to touch him. He took the blind man by the hand and led him outside the village. When he had spit on the man's eyes and put his hands on him, Jesus asked, "Do you see anything?" He looked up and said, "I see people. They look like trees walking around." Once more, Jesus put his hands on the man's eyes. Then his eyes were open. His sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. I want to tag this particular text on today by calling it an assessment. An assessment. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Sigmund Freud, some of y'all know who he is. Yeah. Sigmund Freud was booed from the podium when he first presented his ideas to the scientific community in Europe. But he went back to his office and kept on writing until people received his studies. Thomas Edison's teacher said he was too stupid to learn anything. Thomas Edison was fired from his first two jobs because he was said to be non-productive. It took him 1,000 attempts at the light bulb before getting it to work successfully, but I'm glad to tell you he got it, and you can look at the lights on today. Henry Ford failed and went broke 5 times before he succeeded and was able to produce an assembly line for the Ford car. Some of y'all have Fords on today. R.H. Macy failed 7 times before his New York store caught on and became a large department store and moved his stores all across the world. Some of y'all even shop at the Macy's on today. Hank Aaron batted 0 out of 5 his first time at bat with the Milwaukee Braves before becoming one of the best batters in history. Walt Disney was fired by a newspaper editor because they felt he lacked imagination and had no good ideas. He also went bankrupt several times before building Disneyland, where the city of Anaheim initially refused him because they thought it would attract riffraff. And some of y'all have been to Disneyland on today. When Sidney Poitier did his first acting audition, the casting director told him, "Why don't you stop wasting people's time? Go out and be a dishwasher or something." That's when Sidney decided to become an actor and went on to have a legendary career. Church, I want to say, we got to remember the old saying, when the going gets tough, the tough got to get going. There was a man by the name of Jawad Ahmed Farid. He's an FSA. He says that going back to the drawing board is what true success is all about, and that failure, with the comparative isolation it can bring, is a great time to re-examine your life and to decide if this is what you want out of it. We must know that spiritually and physically, church, sometimes we must make a conscious decision to re-examine what has happened, a conscious decision to get up, and a conscious decision to try again. So my question to you on today is, where is it in your life you need to finish what you started? Where is it that you need to give it another try and allow God to bless you? Sometimes in life, we are ready to call it quits. Anybody ever been there? We are satisfied with what we've done. We're okay with the level we have attained. We become frustrated, however, because of the obstacles that stand in front of us. And then I like to say, in the midst of that frustration, we become complacent because we know that we can have better. Somebody needs to know that today. We know we can do better. Somebody needs to hear that today. We know that there is something else we can do in our situation. We know that we have created, what we have created deserves just a little bit more to reach perfection. We have to ask ourselves, church, are we okay with mediocrity or do we want the best? When we take on a project, do we look for an okay outcome or do we look for the best? Church, the same thing applies in our spiritual lives. Are we looking to become okay disciples of Christ or are we looking to be the best followers of Christ that we can be? The choice is yours. Rest assured, however, in your process, whatever you decide will be displayed before the world to see. In essence, in every area of our lives, we must do an assessment. There are three things that occur, in my opinion, during your assessment period. One is to realize, two is to redo, and three is to read. Somebody needs to write that down. One is to realize, two is to redo, and three is to reap. These apply in the spirit realm as well as in the physical. The Bible says, when he had spit on the man's eyes and put his hands on him, Jesus asked, do you see anything? Here, church, Jesus is attempting to realize the truth of the situation. He asked the man if he saw anything after spitting on his eyes and laying hands on him, not because he was not confident in his power to heal, but to make sure the man's vision was clear and his purpose there that day had been served. The blind man responded that he saw men as trees walking around. So Jesus was making an assessment first, L. He was looking to get the reality of the situation. Now, I came to tell somebody, don't be afraid to do an assessment. Deacons, don't be afraid to do an assessment. If Jesus can do an assessment of his healing power, surely you can do an assessment in your life. I believe today during this Lent season, we need to assess our discipleship. We need to assess our discipleship. Have we truly demonstrated that we are followers of the Christ and committed to doing God's word? During this Lent season, we need to assess our love. Have we demonstrated that we can love one another, no matter what happens between us on this side of heaven? Let me say now, we don't always have to like each other. We don't always have to be in each other's presence or in each other's face. We don't always have to do things together. But surely we ought to love one another as Christians. The Bible says that we will know, or they will know us by our love. I got to be honest now and tell you that always loving other folks is not easy. Somebody ought to agree with me. If it was, we wouldn't have a need for as many psychiatrists, psychologists, therapists, counselors, and whoever else calls themselves counseling. There wouldn't be a great need for them on today. It's not easy, but we have to be committed to working on our love and working through things that come up to divide us and separate us as the people of God, separate us as the kingdom's kids. During this Lent season, we need to assess our service. What are we doing to allow the Lord to bless others through our gifts and through our talents? How are we demonstrating to God that I am available to be used by you? We're so busy doing our own stuff. We're so busy saying we are working on building our kingdom, building ourselves, building our family, building our business, helping our sister, helping our brother, helping our friends, until we don't have time for God. And remember now, God calls us to serve, even if it's only to tell others about Jesus and what he's done for you. Sometimes we got to do a reality check and realize we are not as well off as we thought. We got to do a reality check and realize we are not seeing as clearly as we thought. We got to do a reality check and realize we're not flying as high as we thought. We got to do a reality check and realize we are not as ready as we thought. We got to do a reality check and realize we are not as equipped as we thought. There is something else we can do. You'll never know what you can do, however, if you don't realize something else is needed, if you don't get your assessment, if you don't connect with the Lord. And so I'm telling you today, do an assessment of your spiritual life. There are three things that occur now, in my opinion, during your assessment period. One is to realize, two is to redo, and three is to read. Now, after making an assessment and realizing the truth of your situation, sometimes there is something more that needs to be done or something needs to be redone. If it is evident that something needs to be redone, we must not hold back on doing it. The Bible says, once more, Jesus put his hands on the man's eyes. Here, church, we are told that again, Jesus laid hands on the man's eyes. Now, we know he had already laid hands on him once. But after an assessment, Jesus realized he needed to do it again. Somebody look at the person sitting next to you and say, ain't nothing wrong with doing it again. Ain't nothing wrong with doing it again. Tell them ain't nothing wrong with doing it again. Church, if we would just understand ain't nothing wrong with doing it again, and that if we would give it another try, we might just be successful. And I believe if we would give it another try, people might begin to see their success rates increase. You see, fear will hold you back from your greatest achievements in life. Somebody missed it. Fear will hold you back from your greatest achievements in life. We must walk by that principle that says nothing beats a failure but a try. Somebody hear me. Nothing beats a failure but a try. And sometimes you gotta try and try again and again and again and again. Sometimes you gotta try and try again. Another time. It means once more. It means in addition to. So that means you got to give it a little bit more than you did before. I don't know if Jesus did something extra when he laid his hands on the man. I don't know if Jesus did something different when he laid hands on the man the second time, but I do know there was a different outcome when he redid the laying on of hands. Sometimes we got to be willing to go the extra mile to get the results that we want or be able to accomplish our goal. Jesus was willing to go the extra mile to make sure that the man could see clearly. Yes, the first time, I know somebody was saying he could see, Bishop, he could see. The first time he lays on him, the Bible informs us that he could see. But Jesus didn't want him just seeing now. He wanted him seeing clearly. Clearly means there's nothing in your way. Clearly means there's nothing blocking you. Clearly means there's nothing hindering you. Clearly means it's just open space, baby. It's open space. There is ease there. Some of us have been seeing on our Christian journey, but we have not been seeing clearly. There are stumbling blocks on our lips. There are blockades in our minds. There is rubble in our hearts and in our hands. There is residue in our spirits and in our souls. We need to clear our space so that God can pour out a tremendous blessing upon each and every one of us. Somebody missed it. Somebody missed it. Let me make this plain. We got to be willing to redo some things in order to be clear in our prayer lines. We got to redo some things in order to be clear in our time of study with the Lord. We got to be willing to redo some things in order to be clear in order to serve God and offer our gifts to the Lord. Y'all ain't hearing me. We got to be clear. We got to be willing to redo some things in order to be clear and give God our hands and our feet and give God a sacrifice of praise. We got to redo some things in order to be clear to give God our all and commit to the church, commit to the assembly of the saints, commit to the fellowship. We got to redo some things in order to be clear to love, not allow anything to make you not love as the Bible instructs us to. It's time that we look to see if there's anything blocking us, if we are clear in any area. If so, we got to get clear today, church. We need to go the extra mile, redo some things, shift some things, change some things, turn some things around in order to bring clarity and wholeness to our lives. Somebody got to be willing to go the extra mile. Somebody's got to be willing to redo some things. Don't be embarrassed, honey. Just do it in the name of Jesus. Don't be embarrassed. Just do it in the name of Jesus. There are three things that occur. Once again, during your assessment period, one is to realize, two is to redo, and three is to read. If you realize the truth of your situation and are willing to redo some things, then you are on your way to reaping the harvest and receiving a blessing that only God can give. When we think about the principle of reaping and sowing, we must always know that you've got to have something in the ground in order to be able to harvest something later. Let me say that again. Somebody needs to write that down. You've got to have something in the ground in order to be able to harvest something later. If you haven't put anything in the ground to grow, then you're just going to be looking at the soil when harvest time comes around. I believe that if we as Christians, as people of God, we begin to sow some things in the spirit realm, we will have a great harvest very soon. Some of you for years have been still sowing, so I came to say don't stop, God's gonna bless. Some of you have recently started sowing, I came to say don't stop, God's gonna bless. Some of you want to begin sowing, and you're saying, Bishop, I don't know how, but I'm willing. And I tell you, start sowing today. Sow love, sow joy, sow peace, sow forbearance, sow kindness, sow goodness, sow faithfulness, sow gentleness, sow self-control, sow forgiveness, sow encouragement, sow hope, sow truth, and sow togetherness. If you would sow these things in the spirit and allow it to manifest in the natural, you'll be blessed beyond belief and reap a harvest in your life. The Bible says here, then his eyes were opened, his sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. Here it is clear to me that if you would just try again, the blessings will come. We can follow the example of Christ here and never give up on the blessings coming our way. I believe that's why you've got to give it another try. on today. Sometimes, yes, the people may tell you, you got to know when to hold up and when to fold up. But I believe some of us as Christians fold up too quickly. We got to hang on in there. We got to stand the shield and see the salvation of the Lord. We got to know that the battle is not given to the swift or to the strong, but to the one who endures to the end. Jesus is asking you to stay in the game a little while longer on today. Give me the chorus, Derek. Because the enemy wants you to get out right before your breakthrough. The enemy wants you to give in right before your overflow. The enemy wants you to turn around right at the brink of your blessing. So you got to make up in your mind, I'm gonna press my way. I'm gonna go at this again. I'm gonna keep going until the Lord tells me to stop. If I have to do something again to get me where I need to be, I'm willing to do it. To do it for the Lord. The bottom line, church, is what are you willing? What are you willing to do for the Lord? I believe that's the question. You say you are a Christian. You say you are a servant. You say you are one of God's chosen. I need somebody to walk the talk today. It's time to assess your life. I believe somebody's gonna come out with their blessing. Because remember, there is always a blessing at the end of the assessment. Somebody's gonna make it to the end of your assessment, and come out greater than before. I came to tell you that it's blessing time, church. It's blessing time. Somebody's gonna come out with a renewed mind and see things better than you saw them before. Somebody's gonna come out, church, come out with renewed strength and do more than you did before. Somebody's gonna come out, church, come out with favor. Get this favor and fear, but it's for you. Somebody's gonna come out with power divine to do anything but fail. Somebody's gonna come out with new gifts and a fresh anointing to serve like never before. Somebody's gonna come out with new direction in a new dimension to go where you've never gone before. Anybody ready to reap? Anybody ready to reap what heaven has for you? Get ready to read.
assessment on today. Make an assessment and get ready for what God has for you. Maybe there's somebody here on today that wasn't sure what you needed to do, but you now realize you need to first make an assessment of your spiritual life. You need to first make an assessment of what types of things you are doing, what types of things you are sowing, what types of things you have been putting out and putting in the soil. And so once you begin to look at those things, realize that there are some things you need to redo. Realize there are some things you need to change. And once you redo those things, believe me, you will reap a tremendous harvest. And so God is ready for you. Are you ready for God? That's the real question. Are you ready for the blessing? Are you ready for everything that God has promised to do? God has promised to do some great things, but are you ready on today? Where are you on your journey? Have you confessed Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Have you confessed that you believe that Jesus died for you on the cross, that Jesus saved you, and that everything is now behind you? Have you made the confession that you believe that? If you have not made that confession, we want you to stand and come to the front and put your hand in the hand of the man that died on the cross for you and washed you with his own blood and saved you so that you might have an opportunity to live eternally with God in heaven. Would you all stand? The doors of the church are now open. Maybe you made that confession, but you've been out of church for a while. You've not been in God's house. You've not been serving in God's house. You've not been worshiping. You've just been kind of floating. You've just been kind of existing. You've just kind of been around because you were disappointed at what people told you about the Lord and what they told you about God, what they told you about the Holy Spirit. Well, I came to tell you today, God loves you. God loves you just as you are. I came to tell you, God affirms you. God affirms you in who you are. God affirms you in how you identify, how you express yourself. God affirms you. God created you in God's own image. And God dwells in each and every one of you. I came to tell you today, if you've been sitting out because you felt that God did not want you, God did not love you, God made some type of mistake and you are bound to go somewhere else, I came to tell you today, you are not. You are bound to be in heaven with the Lord. If you stay connected to Christ, continue to work in the church and continue to do as God would have you to do as a Christian on today. And so if you are here and you've been out of the church and you now realize that you can be a part of the church, you realize that you can serve in the church, you realize that you can use your gifts and your talents in the church, we want you to come forward at this time and join with ELC, this church that affirms you, this church that always lets you know that God loves you, this church that doesn't just say it, but we teach you how in the Bible God never says that you were condemned to hell. We teach you how in the Bible God never says that there was a problem with the way that you love or anything that you do. We teach you that man and culture is who has said that. And so we can teach you to love yourself and to love the God who loves you and embraces you. Will there be one on today? If you are here and you want to become a part of this church, we ask that you would come forward at this time. The deacons will walk you down. If you're watching my live stream, Facebook Live, you can go to empowermentliberationcathedral.org. And there is a drop-down menu that says join us. You can become a member of an affirming church, a church where you don't have to pretend, a church where you don't have to be sitting with your friend, your sister, your girlfriend, your cousin,
your neighbor. You don't have to be sitting with your co-worker. You can sit with your spouse, your partner, your lover, whoever you want to sit with. And you can be honest and authentic in your worship. Go to Empowerment Liberation Cathedral and you can become a member of this great church, or you can become a virtual member if you live outside of the Maryland, D.C., Virginia area. But we want people to connect with God. We want people to connect with your Creator. And we want people to know that it's not okay that you feel that God does not love you. It's not okay that you feel that there is something wrong with you. It's not okay that you feel that God made a mistake when God made you. It is not okay. We want you to know that God loves you in all of who you are. In your tallness, in your shortness, in your thickness, in your thinness, in your dark hair, in your light hair, with your heels on, with your shoes on, Lord's shoes on. We want you to know that God loves you. So with everyone on today, the doors of the church are open. With everyone on today, you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. For that word from on high, the Lord had a word for us on today. We are so grateful that Bishop had the strength, the vigor, and the tenacity to come to us today with that great word. We are so grateful to God for your strength, for your healing power, and for his authority over your life. Amen. Church is giving time. It's giving time. It's giving time. I will bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. It's time for us to come and to give joyfully and bountifully. For when you sow something, you can reap something. I would just like to say that it is our prayer that something has been done or said that would give you a closer walk with thee as you go through your week. I want to say thank you once again to Deacon Brooks for her service, to her bishop doing her recuperative time. If it had not been for her, I wouldn't be standing here. Our house is just a little bit too much for me to run up and down, but God has blessed us, and I think next week Bishop may be coming downstairs.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Them steps a little bit much for her to handle, but we thank God that she continues to get stronger. I want to say to the honor bearer of this house, happy birthday. We love you. We thank God for your giving, for your service to your bishop, you and your lovely wife, and we ask that God would bless you with many more. Amen. And to each of you, thank you so much for your kindness, for your words of encouragement to Bishop during her recuperative period. You know, it's important that we pray one for another, that we take not each other for granted. For it could have been you sick in your bed.
Amen.
And so we never find it robbery to call you or encourage you, and I thank you for not finding it robbery to call, to text, and to encourage your bishop, your pastor. And to my beloved wife, thank you so much for putting up with me for 4 years. I don't know how you've done it, but I know that the Lord has been on your side. And I just want to say that I love you with all of my heart, that I pray for you each and every day, and I thank God for sending you my way.
Yes, yes.
And I'm never apologetic for the love of my wife before anybody.
That's right, first lady.
Yeah, that's right.
As we go out on this week, I once again implore each of you to take a little nugget with you. Bishop preached a powerful sermon today. That's how we ought to walk the walk and talk the talk. If you want to see something different at ELC, you be the difference.
It's not up to the pastor. God gave her a vision, but God has to send disciples into the vision. Sheep beget sheep. We have over 200 people on the roll, but so many of them find it to be bribery to come into God's house each and every Sunday. They pick and choose what Sunday they're going to come, what Sunday they're not going to come, what Sunday they're going to go to brunch, what Sunday they're going to go to a party, what Sunday they're going to go play, what Sunday they got to go get their hair done, a haircut. But when they look at you and they ask you, something different is about you, you ought to say, yeah, it's because I go to ELC. Your life should be the witness to someone else. Don't get the attitude, well, I can't be concerned about them. Who else is going to be concerned about our brothers and sisters? We are our brothers and sisters' keepers. So this week, Bishop has charged us to get five. I implore you next week to pray at least one. Don't come to church by yourself. When I was little, I couldn't go to church by myself. Our friends would laugh at us if we didn't bring a friend to church. That's how serious that thing was. We have to get serious. This is not a gay church. This is a church of God.
That's right. Say it again. Yes.
Who happens to have a spiritual leader who is authentic in her walk. Don't be apologetic for your sexual orientation or for who you are, even for where you worship the Lord. For in this house, we worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Yes. So that everything that has breath come in here to praise the Lord.
Yes. Yes.
Invite a friend. Invite a co-worker. Invite a family member. But more importantly, bring yourself to church. If all of our members were here, we wouldn't have room enough. They want Bishop to cover them in prayer, cover them when they're sick, marry them, but they don't want to come to church. And so if you're listening on live stream, I implore you to cut off the TV and next Sunday meet me here. Let me reach out and touch somebody's hand so that I can make this world a better land. We complaining about Trump and what Trump is doing. We complaining about this and complaining about that. But let us come and reason together. Let us come and pray together. And I guarantee you we can turn some things around. Let us stand to our feet. I'm going to ask if our praise team would come back. I need you. You need me. And if we are willing to walk together and pray together and be community together, we can make a difference in this place. Let us come into the aisle and hold hands. Let us touch our brother or sister. Let us share in love and in our hearts.
We're all apart.
assessment of our spiritual life. Let us make an assessment of our natural lives. Let us be willing to try again. Let us be willing to try again and again and again and again until the blessings fall down upon us. God, we just ask that you would open up the windows of heaven and pour us out a blessing that we won't have room enough to receive. God, I ask that you would do the great things that you promised you would do for your people. God, I ask that the prayers of the righteous would avail much, oh God, and that you would, God, respond and answer those prayers. And I ask, oh God, that the people might truly reap the harvest. God, we thank you for greater. We thank you for the greater that has already come. Thank you for the fact that greater is here. And we're going to walk in the blessings and the overflow and the abundance of God. God, we thank you for everything that's going to come with greater. Thank you for the healing that's going to come with greater. Thank you for the deliverance that's going to come with greater. Thank you for the breakthrough that's going to come with greater. Thank you, oh God, for everything that we've asked for that's already going to outflow and outpour in greater. God, we thank you for the believers on today. Thank you for the people who are walking by faith and not by sight. Thank you for the people who are confessing your word and trusting you at your word. Thank you for the people who refuse to listen to the naysayers. Thank you for the people who refuse to listen to the instigators. Thank you for the people who refuse to listen to the dream killers and vision stealers. Thank you for the people who say, I'm going to listen to God. I'm going to stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Help us to see clearly, oh God. Thank you, oh God, for moving the obstacles out of the way. Thank you, oh God, for this great church. And thank you, oh God, for every leader in this church. Thank you for Bishop Emeritus Williams. Thank you, oh God, for every person that is praying. Thank you, God, for every person that is serving. Thank you, God, for every person that is doing anything. God, we just thank you and we bless your holy name. And now on to him who is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the throne with exceeding great joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be majesty, power, glory, and dominion, both now, henceforth, and forevermore. Let all the people of God shout, greater,
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 greater
is here.
God bless you.